Good afternoon.
I put it, I did, and it's making me cough, it's a cough.
For those of you who don't know me, my name's Jerry Markins, and I'm one of the pastors at Rock Prairie Church here in Tipton. On behalf of the family, I'd like to welcome you here today as we celebrate the life of Scott Lee Smay, a beloved father, son, grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the 59 years of life that you gave to Scott. We thank you for the impact his life had on those who knew him, for the value he placed on people. We thank you that he knew the joy of loving and being loved. And most importantly, Father, we thank you that on this side of eternity, Scott knew your son, Jesus, as his Savior. Pray that in the coming moments that we would faithfully honor the life that he lived. And Lord, most importantly, that you would be pleased with all that's said. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
As we begin, I just want to say to the family that I'm so sorry for your loss. And there is no need to feel self-conscious about tears. Today is, of course, a time to mourn. But along with those tears, I think funerals are a good time to smile and to reminisce and to remember good memories, recollect some of the things that made your loved one unique. So yesterday afternoon, I had the chance to sit down with the family and to talk about some of those things and to hear some of those stories. And these are some of the things that they shared with me. Sharon said Scott was a lot like his father. He had a temper like a buzzsaw, but he was truly a loving and caring person. She went on to tell a story about when Scott was just a little guy. He was the youngest of the four kids in the family and the only one without a bike. So one day, Kent came home with a little Schwinn for Scott. And Sharon said, honestly, I was really mad about that. I didn't think he was old enough to be riding with the other three, and they didn't really want their baby brother tagging along anyway. But he rode the wheels off that little Schwinn. If the older three thought they could outride him, he just pedaled harder, and he kept up no matter where they went. As the years went by, those four Smay siblings became good friends, and Scott had a deep love for his brothers and sisters. Beth said Scott was always up for an adventure, whether it was camping or boating or four-wheeling or whitewater rafting, whatever else. But she also said the boat that they owned was cursed. Without going into a lot of detail, the whole family told me stories about the boat nearly sinking in the middle of a lake, the boat on its trailer nearly pulling them over the edge of a cliff, the boat resulting in Nick getting a chipped tooth, the boat resulting in Beth breaking her toe, and Emily having a complete meltdown when she fell off the tube and thought they were leaving her in the middle of the lake. I feel sorry for whoever bought that boat. Speaking of adventures, Nick told me of a time when he was a kid that Scott wanted to take him camping in the Smoky Mountains. And he had a plan that they were just going to sleep in the bed of Scott's truck. So he had an air mattress, and all they needed was a topper. So they borrowed one. But since it was borrowed, it didn't really fit the truck. It wasn't made for the truck. And Scott figured it would be good enough, but what he didn't figure on was a torrential downpour. Camping in the bed of a truck with an ill-fitting topper during a downpour doesn't work out all that well. And it's even worse when your air mattress keeps deflating and won't keep you up out of the water that's filling the bed of the truck. But it did make for a memorable trip and a fun story to share. Later on that same trip, Scott decided they should have another adventure by going on a canoe trip. Nick said they had a choice, a 2-mile trip, a 5-mile trip, a 10-mile trip, or a 36-mile trip. I'll let you guess which one they took. Scott, being a truck driver and used to being in a truck, thought 36 miles didn't seem like all that far. But also, being a truck driver and used to being in a shaded cab, he didn't think about sunscreen or rapids. I'll let Nick tell you the rest of that story later this evening. I think every member of the family said that I had to mention Scott's love of his animals. He loved his cat, who he called Bubby, and he really loved his dog, Gomez. Pretty much every restaurant worker on the west end of Kokomo knows Gomez by name because, as Scott would say, Gomez lives to ride. Every chance he got, Scott would take Gomez in the car and they'd go through a drive up and get some food. And a lot of the workers had a special stash of snacks just for Gomez. Emily said Scott wasn't great at showing his emotions, but every once in a while he would do something that surprised her. One of those things was a bracelet that he bought for her. And these are the words that are inscribed on it. I may not have given you life, but life has given me you. Nick said one thing he'll always be glad about is that his dad got to recognize or realize his dream of owning his own truck. For those who don't know, he named the semi-Trinity Covenant, and the number is 777. God said he wanted everyone to know that it was God's truck. And finally, I have to mention this. Scott was crazy in love with Ava. Nick told me it wasn't unusual for him to have babysitting set up for Ava so that he could go to work for the evening, and Scott would make him cancel those arrangements so that he could spend the evening with Ava. But usually what would follow was an irritated Scott calling Nick at work to say, "You got to teach her not to climb up the back of my chair." But honestly, as a grandpa myself, I'm sure he didn't mind all that much. If we had time, we could probably stay here for hours just recalling memories of special times and memories that each of you shared with Scott. But now we're left with a question. What now? We've already discussed the fact that to feel grief at a time like this is completely natural. But what comes next? Where do you find hope in the midst of your grief? And to find that hope, I would take you directly to the Holy Word of God. And of all the places we could turn in times of grief, it's especially precious to read about Jesus during these times. One follower of Jesus was a man named John who wrote about Jesus' life and his gospel according to John. And it's in that book that we read the most famous verse in all the Bible. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. One of the many stories that John records in his Gospels tells us about a friend of his named Lazarus. And what I'm about to read is a paraphrase of John chapter 11, where John writes, "Jesus and his disciples heard that Lazarus, who lived in a town called Bethany, was very sick. Now Jesus loved Lazarus and his sisters Mary and Martha. And after 2 days, Jesus told his disciples, 'Lazarus has died. And for your sake, I'm glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him.' By the time Jesus arrived in Bethany, Lazarus had been dead in his tomb for 4 days. Lazarus' sister Martha ran out to meet Jesus, and Jesus said to her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?' She said to him, 'Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world.' Then Lazarus' other sister, Mary, came out to meet Jesus. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.' When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, 'Where have you laid him?' They said to him, 'Lord, come and see.' Jesus wept. So the Jews said, 'See how he loved him.' But some of them said, 'Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?' Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, 'Take away the stone.' Then he prayed to his father and cried out with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come out.' And the man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, 'Unbind him and let him go.'" The story of Lazarus teaches us several important lessons for facing times of grief. And the first one is this: we need to take time to grieve. Sometimes we convince ourselves that what we need to do is to be strong and press on for the sake of those around us. But when Jesus, the Son of God himself, came to Lazarus' tomb, he didn't try to be strong and hold back his tears. He wept. When we love someone dearly as Jesus loved Lazarus, it's natural to cry. It's part of God's plan that we go through a grieving process when we experience loss. The Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes that there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Holding back tears is not necessarily a sign of being strong. It may just mean that we're scared to accept how we feel. Some people never allow themselves time to grieve, and it only hurts them in the long run. It's okay to grieve. It's important to grieve. It's good to remember the times we've spent with a loved one, even though it hurts. When Jesus saw the tomb of Lazarus, he faced what had happened. He likely reflected on memories that he had shared with Lazarus, maybe when they were reclining at the table eating one of Martha's famous meals. Even though Jesus had the power to resurrect Lazarus in that very moment, he paused and took time to grieve over death. We live in a demanding world that tries to kind of push us along to the next thing. But when tragedy strikes in our family, we need to take time to pause and grieve. You all share many memories with Scott. Those memories are precious. Take time to remember. Take time to grieve. It's okay. Jesus wept. Second, the story of Lazarus reminds us that Jesus understands our grief. In the dark times, we sometimes feel like God is far away and that he can't possibly understand what we're going through or what we feel. But Hebrews 4:15 confirms that God is able to sympathize with us because he came to earth as a man. He lived as a man. He lived as Jesus. He endured all the worst kinds of suffering, from the loss of his friend Lazarus to rejection by his own people to torture and death on the cross. Whatever we're going through, Jesus really does understand. The Bible reassures us that when we pray to God in hard times, he hears us. The author of Psalms 116 wrote these words: "I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my pleas for mercy. Because he inclined his ear to hear me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live." My friends, God understands our grief. Third, the story of Lazarus reminds us that God has a purpose for everything we experience in life. Both Mary and Martha said to Jesus, "If you had been here, you could have stopped our brother from dying. You could have healed Lazarus. So why didn't Jesus come earlier?" Well, he explained the reason to his disciples. "Lazarus became sick and died for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." He said, "For your sake, I'm glad I wasn't here, so that you may believe." God saw the bigger picture, the eternal destinies of Lazarus' family and the people who were mourning with them were at stake. When Jesus raised Lazarus from the grave, the crowds were unable to deny his deity, his power, and no doubt many came to believe in him that day. When we experience tragedy, we often ask why. Romans 8:28 is a precious promise. It says, "We know that all things work together for them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose." And if you love God, you can be confident that he will take the worst possible situation, even the death of a loved one, and use that to accomplish something good. And if you don't love God, I have good news for you. You can come to know him. You can come to love him. Wouldn't Scott be thrilled to know But a good thing that came out of today was that some of his friends and family came to know his Lord and his Savior. I don't know if that will be the case, but what I do know is that God always has a purpose for everything that happens. Finally, the story of Lazarus reminds us that Jesus is the Lord of life and death. Jesus proved to everyone that he was fully God by the incredible miracle of calling Lazarus forth from the tomb. Now you might think, what good is this story to us? Because Scott's not going to come back to life. So what good is this story? But the Bible tells us that someday we will all be raised from the dead and face God. Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Everyone who believes in me shall never die." And then he asked her a question. He said, "Do you believe this? What would your answer be? Would you say to Jesus, 'Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God'?" How you answer that question is supremely important, because the Bible teaches that we have all sinned. We have all disobeyed God's law. We have all ignored God and lived our own way with our own desires. And God calls that sin. Romans 3:23 says that the penalty of sin is death. Not just physical death, but spiritual death and eternal separation from God. But the good news is that God is so loving that while we were yet sinners, he sent his Son to pay the penalty for our sins. In other words, what should have happened to us happened to Jesus instead. He died in our place. He had no sins of his own, so he took our sins upon himself and paid the debt that we owed to God. And the even better news is that Jesus didn't stay dead. On the third day, he demonstrated his authority and his power over death by rising from the grave. Just as with Lazarus, God raised him from the dead. And today, Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, praying to his Father for us. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. To accomplish that, we confess our sins, we turn from our sins, and we look to him as our only hope for salvation. Romans 10 promises that if we confess with our mouths Jesus as Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. We will be eternally with him. Death is a solemn reminder, but it also points us to the most wonderful, hope-filled message of all, that Jesus is the Lord of life and death, and whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. Everyone here can one day be received by Jesus. And I can assure you that nothing would make Scott happier than knowing that all of us are spending the remainder of our days here on this earth following his God, following his Savior. I'll close our time together here today with this. Back on December 14th, Scott posted on Facebook about a song by the band Casting Crowns. You've heard several of their songs today, but this particular song is entitled Only Jesus, and it's a song about legacy. In just a moment, we're going to hear that song, but I want you to hear Scott's words about that song first. This is what he posted. "This song so motivates me to have a closer relationship with Jesus, my Lord and Savior, to give more, to pray more, to be better to others, and to serve more, to get over the hump of being lackadaisical. I want to be remembered as giving to the poor and serving Jesus. Thank you, God, for using instruments such as songs to draw us closer to you. May we all be remembered for being servants of God." So let's listen now to the song that Scott was writing about.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can
Father, we thank you again for the life you gave to Scott. We thank you for the many gifts you placed in his life, a loving family, lots of adventures, and most importantly, a relationship with your son. Father, I pray for this family that in the coming days they would feel you near, that they would feel your presence, that they would lean on each other, their respective social circles would come around them, Lord, and support them, and that they would take comfort in knowing that Scott is in the loving arms of his Savior. Be with us in the remainder of our time together today, I ask in Jesus' name.
We're gathered here today to commit to this resting place, the body of Scott Lee Smay, a beloved son, father, grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend. Reading from the 139th Psalm. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You understand my thought from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down and are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before there's a word on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. You have enclosed me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain to it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in the grave, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand will lay hold of me. If I say, surely the darkness will overwhelm me and the light around me will be night, even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. For you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Life at its best is short. Many of you know this, but before I was in the ministry, I worked as a nurse. I've had the privilege of knowing a number of people who live to be over 100 years old. And even those individuals have all told me, it just seems like yesterday that I was a child. Life is short. Make the most of every day. And know that we brought nothing into the world and we can carry nothing out. Even in the midst of life, all of us are constantly moving toward our ultimate end. But we are in no way without hope. The scriptures tell us that it's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance, and repentance leads us to God's greatest gift, the gift of eternal life, through Christ Jesus our Lord. May each and every gift of God's kindness remind us of his love toward us in Christ Jesus our Lord. We commit now the body of this loved one to this resting place, and his spirit we leave with God. For shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Let's pray. Father, I once again thank you for the 59 years of full life that you gave to Scott. Thank you for the legacy of love that he leaves behind. The people gathered here testify to that. Lord, I pray that they would feel you close in the days to come, that they would take solace in knowing that Scott is with you, and that they would bind together as a family and friends and love one another through the grieving process. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.